You have a lot of materials in front of you. What I thought we might do tonight is go through the operating budget first, and then the capital budget second. And then Tony has some projections and revenue, of course, and he has a number of exhibits to share with you tonight. So why don't we start with the Board of Selectmen budget? And we, Tony and I, have met and come up with these recommendations on the Board of Selectmen budget.
Okay.
Do you want to just, Tony, give us a...
Sure. This, I guess this is probably a good place to start, and this is a three-year projection on our budget. And as you all know, we have a number of items coming up in the budget for the next few years, including some debt service at the fire station, there's the OPEB liability, and there's sure. energy, a couple other issues.
Just explain what OPEB.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. The OPEB is the other post-employment benefit liability that the town is going to fund in its budget over the next several years.
And this is the first time we've ever done
it. First time we're doing it, correct. So that concludes the town and the Board of Education. So as you can see, that's why I put in here some of those issues, and it's just for you to review, but there's a couple of assumptions here. The it assumes no increase in state funds, which I think is probably a safe assumption, as I haven't gotten any indication that that'll be increasing. Also, a downward trend in interest rates and in the interest investment income, and a slight increase in fees and permits. It's on the revenue side. On our grant list, it's a same increase for next year as it was for this year, and then a slightly lower increase the year after, because we won't have the personal property from the electrical power lines that we'll have this year and next year. So that doesn't, of course, account for the fact that the Woodbridge Village may come in, and that's something that may happen. Mm-hmm. I didn't project it, but mm-hmm. it's something that could happen. And on the education side, the Amity Regional School District number is actually from Amity, which is great considering as several years ago I first started, we didn't even have a budget until like April. So it's great that I can call and we can exchange information and get a three-year projection as to where they think their budget is going. And then there's the Board of Education after speaking with Chuck there. And then the departmental expenditures I broke out by like, type. And I kept most of it flat except for salaries, of course, and a tip fee reduction, hopefully, for tip fees are our annual garbage fees that we pay. And you'll see later on in the budget there's a large increase this year for some closure costs that we're going to assume because the project's closing next year. So
that is not from power lines? Is that it?
The numbers in the grant list for the assessment, I increased it a little because of the power line
okay.
assessment.
That's included for actual?
For 2009 and 2010, it's in two segments. For how much is that? One way, one to the other. The number was personal property, it was $400,000, I think.
A year?
Yeah, over several years, $400,000 to $500,000 over a couple of years.
Is it a one time?
So, no, it's half this year, half in 2009, half in 2010.
And after that?
It's bad. It's just a two because it's still in the number, but in terms of an increase, it's not increasing anymore. So it'll still be in the figure.
It's flat.
So and then there's an increase in energy costs, and that's also increased there. So and then healthcare and benefits are increased by.
I think when you put this to the public, you should think about of the increase in money we're going to get from the power lines. Just mm-hmm. for those who are suffering from looking at those monstrosities, at least they should know that we're getting.
They look more beautiful now.
Yeah, $200,000.
Yeah, in our budget presentation.
Yeah, we that would be
better. Yeah.
Absolutely.
I like them better than the old ones.
Yeah.
I like them better than oranges.
Yeah.
Hey, at least
they're
not brown.
Yeah.
Rusty.
But anyway, it sure feels better at least if we're getting $250,000 a year to look at them. Mm-hmm.
That's a good point, Jeff.
Absolutely. So this is, you see the increase there is actually, there were some things you'll encounter later in the budget. OPEB is one, the way the OPEB was funded, taking consideration the couple of bigger hits they have in 2010, including the debt service. And, that's just for your review, just to kind of give us a ballpark. It's just a planning tool, really.
And you're really a five-year decrease in interest?
I think so.
Is that in line with what?
I mean, the 07 is an actual, and 08 is probably very close to what we had. And so next year, the budget will increase a little. I just see the...
I hope you're wrong.
I hope so, too. Okay, so that's just for you to review and keep in mind as we move forward here.
Okay, so we're going to start with the Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
You'll see under that column.
Are there any questions or anything on that?
Column 2008-9, Board of Selectmen proposed.
Do you want me to just go through?
Why don't you just highlight, yeah.
Okay.
We made some changes in those.
One was an increase in litigation from 20 to 25,000, and that was more based on where we think we may have our actual expenditures for next year.
Mainly that's due to land use litigation.
Most of it's land use, correct.
Where are you reading?
That's 52,130.
130. Line is the census line. There was a slight reduction there just to bring it back to where the prior year was, just based on the projection. There is regional services was reduced slightly to be more in line with where the projected budget is for the 08 year. And we did receive a number of the municipal agencies have submitted their requests, and so that should be pretty close to where we should be there. Other purchase services, again, was just a small reduction to match the projection of the current year. And programs and publicities, that was reduced from $3,500 to $1,000. And that was, there's two things that are funded out of that line. One is the overtime for the carnival, and one is the concerts. The overtime for the carnival was removed from the line. The year, the line after that is meeting supplies. That is in was reduced in hopes of possibly having one meeting per month at the Board of Selectmen.
Or we bring our own dinner.
Or you bring your own food for one meeting, right?
Brown,
it's a potluck.
Brown bag. Right?
And finally, the capital item was reduced to zero. It was a desk request, which was removed from the budget. Highlights
on
the
board.
Excited.
What I want to do is maybe go out of turn here to the Parks Department budget, because Bob Gregg is here, who has some, he's a representative of the Land Trust. That's correct. And that's number 1520. And he has some comments to make about what we have in the budget for part-time seasonal in relation to undertaking to maintain further work on maintenance of the trails. And so Bob, can give you a little bit of time here to make some comments about that.
Yeah, I have gone into trouble writing these out, so I'll pass it out to you, but I'll give you a brief summary of it. Back in 1972, I built a house in Woodbridge, and in the middle 70s, my wife became secretary of the Woodbridge Land Trust. About 1975, I started doing a lot of hiking and trail work. In 1985, I got to be the secretary of the Land Trust. I must admit, there was a couple of people asked if I thought I was competent to handle the job, but I've been associated with the Land Trust since then. Now, at that time, the Parks Association maintained the trails in Alice Newton over here, and the trust maintained the trails and all the rest of the town. The trust at that time hired a seasonal worker in the summer, usually a Yale forestry student, to work on the trails. And, well, in 1975, when Hubbard, who was chairman of the trails in the trust at that time, hired a fellow named Michael McCune, and among other things, he built a bridge on the trails in Fitzgerald. And board members were assigned trails to walk and report on maintenance needs. And they met them. Well, that same year, George Mill, who's pastor of the church, along with Bob Hitchcock and Sid Tomlinson, cleared a site over on the West River on the Bishop Estate, laid out plans for a bridge, and appropriated the funds. Duncan Milne supervised the construction of the abutments and the bridge, and 20-odd years later, the land trust faced a deteriorating deck, bought 2x6s, pressure treated, and C.C. Getch and Elizabeth Buckley spiked them on. I mean, so it's been a long history of the trust taking care of trails. The bridge was built 5 feet wide, so Sid Tomlinson could take his tractor, go across the bridge, and lay out trails and maintain them on the other side. Well, in the 90s, I had Eric Demander heading up trails. Eric, Charlie Getch, some of you may remember, sitting on this board, Ron Hedberg, Charlie Griffith, Elizabeth Buckley, she had a huge friend. Remember, he slung a 90-pound canvas bag of tools on his back and go striding along. And we built the boardwalk through the Russell Swamp. And that included bridges and everything else. So the trust has, over the years, been doing this kind of work. Matter of fact, you may remember 11 years ago, we had a formal ribbon cutting ceremony and a walk over the bridge around the property, which was a bit of a demanding walk. I remember picking up Ed over on Sanford Road.
I appreciated that.
And I'd been smart enough not to go on the walk. But that's the general history of it. And, well, over here on the rice pond, there was a blowdown of the evergreens around there. We advertised a work party. Well, quite a few people responded. I remember my chainsaw didn't work, but Duncan Milne was there. Charlie Getch again, and several others. At a later meeting of this board, I showed a picture. It was Eric and I positioning a big trail sign. This was a rather awkward arrangement of a couple of 8-foot 4x4s, in which were nailed 4 sections of 2x10s, like so. And I dug holes in the ground, and Eric and I put them in. If you go around the trails in town, you will find these guideposts at the intersection of all of the major trails. They were built and paid for by the trust. Well, when Jim Malotta became president of the trust, he and I started out to do a GPS survey of the trails in town. That turned out to be a lot of work, and, well, Conservation Commission hired a professional to do the job. They did a nice job, and the trust paid its fair share of the cost. Out in the hall, you'll see some maps prepared by Duncan Milne. Ron Hedberg, over the course of the years, contributed many maps of land use and trails in the town of Woodbridge. And on these signposts we put up, there were trail boxes. We updated, well, I personally did many of the times, the trail maps each year. We tried to keep a supply of them in the boxes, so that those are the things the trust has been doing. Well, now, about 3 weeks ago, you may have seen in the register or the bulletin a picture of the Bethwood Wanderers taken in 1989. The fellow holding up the big pine tree in the background is Robert Gregg, but in the middle of the picture there's a fellow in a stocking cap, Jim Lonergan. He was an inveterate trail walker. I got him to do trail work on the trails in the north part of the town for years. In the south part of the town, Ron Sills, I think his real name was Jerome, he was an Indian. He did trail work around the south end of town, particularly the Park Lane section. Well, I'm a fellow who believes that if you ask for help, you can get it. And we've done that over the years. In our Chestnut Project, we've gotten help from townspeople, from out-of-towners. They show up. They help. Well, recently, Adam Parsons and I have been talking about transplanting an elm tree over here by the library where there's a tree guide and he had cut it down. It's no small job, even with good equipment. At the last board meeting of the trust, I asked for some volunteers for help. Three men put up their hands. You can get help if you ask for it. And we do. As an aside, I might mention at this point how the position of town trail master came about. The Conservation Commission was in the habit of dreaming up trail projects and getting the trust to do them. At one point, I went to a Conservation Commission meeting and suggested they should supply some of the manpower. The response was to appoint Eric Demander, our trail master, as town trail master. That's how the position came about. There are three positions in town that should be contributing to trail maintenance. The trust trail master, the superintendent of the parks, and the town conservation commission's town trail master. At this time, all three positions are held by Mike Walter. He's a hard-working fellow, but he's stretched mighty thin. This afternoon, I tried calling a few people to get some opinions. I haven't run this by the board of the trust, so those are my words, not the words of the trust. I'll give you a copy of them. And I got some comments. One, the trails are on five classes of land. There are trails on town-owned land, such as the Fitzgerald. Town-owned land with a grant of conservation to the trust, such as those off Peck Hill Road, Wallace property. There's Park Association property. There are water company lands on which the trust has an agreement that I won't go into. And there's also private property that these trails run through. And the question is raised whether the town should have an employee doing this work on these various types of land. I was unable to get in touch with many of the board members of the trust, but they are divided in their opinion. They were about 2-1 against the proposition of having the town do it, but there were a couple of members of the board I didn't call that I know would be in favor of. So they are divided. The comments I also got, and these were for a few people outside of the board of the trust that I talked to, they thought it was an unnecessary expansion of town government and expense. Some of them put it in more colorful language, but that was the gist of it. And further question was raised, at least by two people, well, how about other volunteers in town? Aren't they going to want to be paid? One says, well, you start the ball rolling, it's a snowball. I just bring the comments to you. So that, in essence, is what I had to say. And I'll give you a copy of this. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, questions.
Anyone have any questions about the remarks? Okay. Well, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you for your input. Okay, going back now to the, move on to the probate court.
Okay. Sure. There are no adjustments.
Okay. Next is the town clerk.
No adjustments there either.
Register our voters.
There was, you'll see throughout the budget, there were some, all the staffing requests or increases over and above to 2.5% were removed and placed in contingency pending review by the personnel committee.
Okay.
So that reduces part-time all other?
Correct. That reduces part-time all other to a 2.5% increase.
From 30,778 to 28,680.
Correct.
Next is government access television. And does anyone have any questions as we go through this? Feel free to ask. Okay.
The this was we spent some time on this last meeting. This is based on the memo provided by the government access TV to take advantage of the grant that was received. And so that was adjusted in the first two lines, which is basically more hours of coordination and more taping and no capital purchases. Mm-hmm. Capital purchases will be made this year and then the other hours for next year.
So that $10,000 grant is
utilized. You'll see the revenue I put in the $10,000, half of it anyway, the part that funds the top two lines.
Tommy, I'm all in favor of all, but I just wonder if we could put a separate line item on it only because it's coming in from the grant.
The only thing is the payment that's being made is consistent with the top two, in other words, it's just an expansion of the top two expenditures.
You can always bring him back down next year if you want. You'll get the salary history.
We just have to remember that's what. I guess we will because we'll see the previous years and issues.
That's what I'm saying. So you'll see the trend.
Let it go. I take it back.
Okay.
All right, general administration.
Then this one here, there's a few items that are still open, again, throughout the budget. We're bidding our gas, oil, and diesel 28th. Yeah, the 28th. So hopefully we'll be able to solidify a lot of those numbers in those accounts.
And insurance.
Insurance also, we're going to also be bidding this year. And that won't be till later in the year. We might not have that number till closer to the town meeting.
Okay. Now, is this a bid for every year or 3-year period?
For which one?
For the gas, the oil, and.
We do that every year.
Every year?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right, information systems. There was two small reductions, just basically to be a little more in line with actual. From the projection, which is the repair and maintenance machinery equipment. And that's mostly if we have a problem with a computer or a server, we have to, you know, replace it just dry or something. And then the training account was just reduced a little.
More to action.
Right, more to action, right. Okay, finance department. Again, the, you'll see I put in technical supplies down at the last. Was request last time. It's a technical. So I've changed that in a lot of the lines. And also in office supplies, so it's just office. Mm-hmm. And that was the fund reduction. Mm-hmm. It's just by $500. So.
Tax collector?
There was nothing in tax collector.
Mm-hmm. Tax assessor.
And another salary reduction.
So that's figured at 2.5%.
Correct.
Any other salaries are in the contingency.
Contingency, right.
Okay. Board of Tax Review?
No change.
Okay. Board of Finance?
You'll see the contingency increase to reflect those salary changes.
Is town plan and zoning.
Should be no changes there.
Changes there. Okay. Next is zoning board of appeal.
No changes there.
The center.
In the center again, you have another oil account. Mm-hmm. So it will be changed, reflecting that hopefully.
Okay. Next is the police department.
Okay. The police department made a few changes. The first was every year I have a based on the salary information, the roster for the police department impacts not only the salary line, but the holiday pay, the longevity, college incentives, all the way down the line. So I made changes to where those actuals are, or where we project them to be for next year, and made the change in the police officer line. You'll see it actually goes down from the year before. Mm-hmm. And one reason for that is we've had some turnover, and so there's a good $10,000 between the two steps. So I think we've had four positions turn over, so you know there's $40,000.
So I'm apologize that I wasn't here when they presented their budget, but there was a request to be at full complements, and that
this is still full complement.
Okay.
The request included there were two errors in the request. One was it double counted the first three lines.
Oh. There was an error in their budget presentation.
Oh, okay.
Right, and then there was another one. So I corrected those errors in the proposed line.
So right. This is at full complement?
Full complement, correct.
Okay. Good catch.
Right.
There's also the overtime changes for police officers was reduced. Again, the theory there is that oftentimes, they're not a full complement. At least they haven't been since I've been here.
Right.
And so, I don't expect that not to continue in some form. As a matter of fact, I do have one injury that probably won't wrap itself or won't rectify itself until at least, you know, in well to next year. So, there's one position right there that we get funded from our workers' comp that pays the salary, so. You know, so that's why the overtime is reduced in light of that.
But generally, we run about 60 a year, huh?
Usually, yeah. You can see the history, 60 this year, 65 the year before. That's a pretty good number. So
you're putting up 30 this year because of workers' comp?
Because there's always vacancies in the police department, or whether it's an injury, whether it's staff turnover, whatever the case may be.
And you can fund that out of the salary account.
Right, and then just transfer it down from the salary account. Because if you don't fully fund the salary line, essentially what you're doing is you're saying that you're not fully funding every position.
Right. So we're committed to full complement.
Right.
Okay.
And then there's a reduction in the telephone line. Just because you'll see the last 2 years were 18 and then 17.
Right.
And then 20.
Okay. Next is the fire commission.
Okay, the fire commission, the chief and the assistant chief lines are accounts payable, stipends, and stuff to payroll. So those it was a request at 3.2%, and that was changed to 2.5% to reflect what the general town increase is projected to be. The fire marshal, the part-time clerical, and the part-time all other are all in contingency because those are personnel-related items.
Okay. Was there an increase in hours related to the part-time clerical?
There was. There was an increase in hours and an increase of 3.2% in salary.
Okay, so were the hours maintained but the salary was not?
No.
Or the hours were put over?
Everything was put into contingency.
Okay. So we're leaving that to the Board of Finance to decide then?
No, the personnel committee has to decide.
We'll make a recommendation for the board of selectmen.
Okay, in terms of increasing hours and things like that.
Correct.
Okay.
Right.
And that'll be funded out of the contingency.
Okay.
All
right.
Volunteer incentives. What exactly are those?
Every year, the town gives all the volunteer fire based on a set of criteria that the association, I believe, sets the criteria based on the calls and that sort of thing. Is given a volunteer incentive and savings bond, basically, as an incentive for service for the town.
Do we get any counting of the other fundraising done by the police and fire department?
I don't know if the police does any fundraising.
Just the fire.
That's through the Volunteer Fire Association.
I give money to the police union.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought there was something.
So that's right.
But that's not from Woodbridge, though.
But anyway, yeah.
Yeah, it's not a Woodbridge police.
But on the fire, do we
I haven't, nor have I asked for.
That's through the Volunteer Fire Association, over which we don't really have any jurisdiction.
It's a separate 501c3 organization.
I mean, I've asked for what they made for Carnival since we were contributing to that.
Mm-hmm. But we do get that information.
Right, but that's it.
What was technical supplies doing?
Technical supplies was, there was a request of 15.5. We reduced it slightly just because if you look at the history there, I know there's some supply increases projected, but we just reduced it a bit, $5,000 just. Same thing with medical expense. There wasn't seem to be, they didn't seem to reach there. I mean, you see 2 years ago, it was 12, that's 12,000 this year.
That's basically physical exams.
Physical exams, right. And, there's always, there's an increase that's less than $1,000 for the fiscal year, that's something that I can do myself.
Mm-hmm.
So if I feel comfortable in reducing the technical by $1,000 and the chief comes to me and says, Tony, phone has increased, and I see it's increased, and
right.
I can always transfer it myself.
So basically, Tony, you left in the assumptions about operating both buildings.
Correct. I know the Board of Finance was interested in pursuing that.
Right.
So we've left it in for the time being.
Okay.
We'll let them have a discussion.
Okay,
we'll
have to give something for it.
That's right.
Okay,
then we come to medical services.
There's the overtime. That's
part-time
clerical is reduced to zero.
Right.
Okay.
Was that person taking minutes at meetings?
Correct, right, yeah, I think we can do that ourselves here.
Okay. So that charge will be given to the commission if they do that?
That's correct.
Okay. That's good.
Commissioner Bowe.
This next figure is actually changed. The 68249 was a proposed budget that I helped work on for the district animal control. And the commission is simply has adopted a budget. It's adopted, right, Joe?
Yeah, yes, they did.
And our portion is $70,918.
You have materials here about the number of calls and complaints and that sort of thing over the past 6 months, 7 months. It fell off, it seems, generally speaking, in the last 6 months of 2007, it seemed to be reduced. There's an increase in January. And of course, there's one prospect that's left.
That's the primary driver.
So there's now three towns, Bethany, Orange, and Woodbridge. We're going to redo the agreement between the three towns, and Jim Perillo is going to work on that.
There's a, in your,
it's about $2,500 for what was in here.
Right.
Correct.
Yeah, there was some slight modifications to the budget.
And we're looking at ways that the town of Woodbridge can assist the financial management of the district animal control through our staff here for a fee to be charged to the district animal control. And I know we're exploring that. Building department.
There were no changes there.
Changes.
You might want to change on your summary sheet. It says building official.
Oh, okay.
You want to say building department.
Yep. Which is a question.
Right.
Yep.
Okay. Next is public works.
Yep, there are no changes there.
No changes. Okay. Waste management.
The increase in tip fees, I'm going to have to get to that page, you have to know that's there, is based on the actual adopted tip fees by CRRA. And a lot of that is post-closure costs. I have that here.
And we're talking here now about a six-month period, right?
Correct.
Wow.
But because we don't know...
July 1 through December 31, 2008.
Right.
$50,000.
Well, that's projected, that's the whole year. What I did was, because we're not sure what the next half of the year is going to bring us. I mean, that's the tip fee stretched off the whole year. So, I mean, you could take half of it and,
sure.
You know, take a gamble.
Okay.
You know, but,
I
have no idea where that's going.
That's a heck of a tip.
That's right.
Well, switch businesses.
Okay. Next is remediation.
Yep.
There's no changes there.
When will that actually go away?
There's a report. We got recommendation from our testing agency to the DEP to reduce the number of tests for the next 6 months. You'll get that in your packet for the March meeting, but
okay. That's
an ongoing process of, it's up to the DEP to approve that. We're asking that they approve this reduction in the number of tests as a result of the big spill and that sort of thing. So I don't have the exact numbers in my head, but that is ongoing to reduce that eventually to nothing, but
okay. When
that will be, I don't know.
Okay. Well, I mean, this was cut in half, so
Yeah,
it's decreasing
so. Significantly over the past few years.
It sounds like we've had three plus years to go, if not more. So. Okay.
Probably.
Good.
All right,
building maintenance.
Yeah, building maintenance, we reduced the overtime back to the current budget. This is currently, that's where it's tracking. Projections probably a little high, unless there's a problem of some sort. The general professional services line is actually based on a budget of all the items that are in there, and that's where that comes from. It includes, it's actually in your budget book, and it lists all the items. The way this budget is organized is that's all of the regular ongoing services that we have for all of our buildings.
Okay.
that are on contract, like elevator inspections, floor mat replacements, pest control, septic maintenance, that kind of thing. Stuff that we have on a regular routine basis. As opposed to the repair and maintenance of buildings, which is if something breaks, something leaks, something happens, it has to be replaced. This is easier for them to track it that way. So
you think that their estimate was too high?
I do. The 41,000 is probably a little too high.
Okay.
Same thing with the supplies. Mm-hmm. I think they probably were a little high on those. The parts especially. And I always tell Joe if, you know, we monitor closely, and if for some reason he has a problem or he needs some additional funding, that, you know, we're not going to not tell him to do stuff.
It's Joe.
You know, Joe, that's right, yeah. And he knows that, you know, we're not going to leave him, you know. So.
The same thing for equipment parts?
Same thing, yeah. I mean, we communicate regularly on his budget, so they're very good about that.
I would also change on this summary sheet, it says building management.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay, the next is human services.
Okay. The two salary pieces, which were the additional hours for the driver for the clerical position that were added as a result of the cut of the state grant, were put in contingency.
Right, for the personal.
Correct.
Okay.
And the other thing was, there was a line called repair and maintenance vehicle, mm-hmm. which actually had gasoline in it, which is probably not correct.
Right.
So, that's not clear. It looks like you're spending $10,000 on repairing a vehicle, which is crazy. So there, we've changed it, and $1,000 is actually an estimate of what the repairs would be, basically, and oil changes, brakes, that sort of thing. And then the gas is down below. That probably makes more sense.
Yes.
Next is recreation department.
Okay, recreation. The part-time maintenance was, there was an increase there that, in recreation, the Recreation Commission actually has you have the authority to hire and change part-time staff. So on this one, it's just the budget for the part-time maintenance, and I believe that was for an additional there was a they added a summer pool director that we kept in there. And just changed the wage discrepancy that was in there that John had discussed. But this was funding for
expanded cleanup for the camp.
Right. Yeah. There's that were the two things. And then there was a yeah, that's expanded cleanup for the camp. The other one was the summer pool director, which we kept in there. Okay. Which was you'll see the one
right, that's in regular assistance.
Right. That's why it's at 11%.
Mm-hmm.
So that's in there, and then the part-time cleanup for the camp
is what you reduced.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, we reduced the programs and publicity to more the actual.
Right.
Right, but you still gave an increase of 1,000.
We did. Right, and the program publicity I think is where they were going to advertise in the paper for some of their programs. That's the main thing that was reduced there. And some of the others are just brought down to closer to where their actuals are this year.
Do you think since they generate revenue, though, from their advertising, that we should cut them back?
You know, you could
I'm just asking
if you think that the advertising will generate what it will do. I'm not sure what.
Yeah, you know, they have the direct contact through through the school.
Mm-hmm.
The children bring home, you know, flyers from them, which I think probably gives a bigger yield than something that's in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
sometimes the children do not bring those things home.
Oh,
we're going to get lost.
Right, but there is the website, and most people know about the Rec Commission, they could easily go on there.
And it's still an 8% increase.
I was just going to say that too, that there's still enough money in that budget where they could probably.
Is there a listserv in Woodbridge where parents can log on and then emails are generated from the superintendent or the principals?
I don't believe so.
I don't think they have a listserv on their site.
That's very, very helpful.
I'll bring it to the board then.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Pool and gym expense?
There was an hour increase in part-time maintenance, which we took out. It was only 1 hour.
Okay, Parks Department?
The part-time seasonal increase of 55 cents an hour for the existing employee and the additional wages for the proposed trail maintenance, both putting contingency. So, you know, that's.
And also, I think two college students to work.
Right, that's the, right.
So I was thinking that the contingency only went up by 50,000, but it's really, that's all it ended up being?
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
For all of these increases?
Mm-hmm.
You're kidding?
Yeah.
Okay.
Tony, can I go back to pool and gym?
Sure.
We have oil meeting where amended budget and projected budget, 12.5. And how did we go from 12.5 in oil of all things down to 1,200?
12,000.
12,000, rather.
Mm-hmm.
I would imagine oil would have at least stayed the same, if not gone up, even if everything else.
That's going to be.
Yeah, I'm going to probably review that when we do the oil bid, and then I'll, if there's a change, I'll have to make that. But you're right, that's probably something I'll have to review.
Was there a different sharing, though, in terms of the building itself?
Beecher, that was a few years ago, I think that was before.
You think it was before?
Yeah. Before, or a few years ago, we used to share more of the building with Beecher, it was just sort of a complicated thing.
I'm not sure if that oil heating isn't for the oil burner that heats the pool.
That's what it's for the pool.
Right.
We used to charge.
Okay, it's only the pool.
That's true, I guess if I can get my hands on some of that oil, that's a good one.
No, they're not going to share that with you, though. All right, so you basically kept it in, you just put it in contingency?
Correct.
For the trails, okay.
Right, it's 25,056.
Okay.
That's the.
That's half of the increase.
Correct, right, that's half the increase.
Okay, so now we're on the Parks Department.
The rest of it is in there. There's increase in, little increases there throughout the department for training, for supplies, for medical uniform. That was still in the, you know, in the budget, so.
Okay, so.
What about the capital furniture and fixtures?
That's for, you mean like the battery?
7470.
Separate discussion.
Okay.
Yeah, that's, I'll tell you first, in one second.
Capital for purpose.
The benches.
Right, those are benches.
But it's minus 55.71.
Right, because the prior year was 3,500, they bought bleachers in.
Okay.
Right.
Got it.
I think that was the good one, the top of the bleachers.
They're made from the same oil as the pool.
So what's your feeling about this part-time seasonal?
I wish we had known that when we went over the budget for the park department, because it would have been good to say, hey, have you explored other volunteer opportunities?
Well, we had a discussion with the trail master.
We had a long discussion.
Right, and he is the volunteer, and you know, I'm not going to speak for him, but I think he's, I don't know how much longer he's willing to volunteer.
No, if he is it, and we can't get anybody else, you know, Dr. Gray seemed to indicate that we have a long tradition here of being able to get volunteers to do it. But if we use that up and that's dried up, we have no choice. We have to maintain the trails.
So.
We can't get the Boy Scouts and.
Oh, this is a kind of a thing, you need chainsaws and things. I mean, this is, you know, you need two people to work together, and they have to be, you know, knowledgeable in the use of this kind of equipment, and.
Gotta get the Girl Scouts for that.
Yeah, that's right.
So we need an internship from the Yale Forestry Department.
Well, we're working on that to give us an overview of the of all this 1,000 acres that we own and what is what we should do to maintain that. And that could be part of this as well. But it seems as though these trails that we invite people to use, we should have to address that.
I think that we could request, if we're going to really take this on as a town responsibility, to really work with the schools and with our, you know, voluntary organizations.
Sure, with Bob Gregg's group, with all these groups,
right.
Yeah.
To really develop a whole system of how do we do this together. Mm-hmm. So you have to have someone in charge of it, and Mike is certainly the best person I could think of to actually do that, Michael Walter. But I think we do need to enlist the town residents and the children and the Boy Scouts and the Girl Scouts and all of those groups so that they each take on a piece of what it takes to do this for the town.
And we need to ask the Parks Department to reach out to those organizations to see what we can. And if we budget it, maybe we don't necessarily have to spend it. We can get volunteers.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Keep it in the budget, and then if we don't use it, the surplus.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. No, I think it should stay.
Yeah, all right. Is that the consent?
Yeah, okay. Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, anything else in the Parks Department?
Would you draft a memo to the Parks Department asking them to do that? Or should we do that collectively?
I think once we get this Yale professor involved in this to give us some direction with this, this will be part of that overall analysis, so we will do that. Okay, anything else in Parks?
Rest of it is
pretty straightforward. Thomas Darling House.
No change there.
No change there. Library.
The library has a library is another commission that can has some flexibility with part-time staff, and so there was a request for. A couple of requests in the part-time regular clerical line, one of which was Sunday hours, mm-hmm. one of which was an increase in the bookkeeper, administrative assistant position.
Increase in hours.
Right, increase in hours. And the other was increase in technical services. And I believe what we did was we cut the technical services line. I had a few questions for the library director, which she's actually been on vacation, so I haven't been able to connect with her on that. But, one thought on that was, in here there's, one of my questions to her was, there's an increase in their hours for technical services, yet there's also, it's something they didn't pick up when we were going through a budget, but there's also an increase, in funding for something that increases, helps them technically work faster.
Right, circulation cataloging.
Yeah,
the millennium
right.
system. Yeah. More
so
hours are needed.
Right, so 4 hours are needed for something that's hopefully gonna saves time, staff time. Right. Yeah. So the two were
in conflict.
Right. So we cut staff time.
Right. We resolve the conflict.
So it still has the increase for the business official and the Sunday hours and the clerical line.
There's a question I'd like to ask you, Tony. The font on some of the words are smaller. Is that because you've made changes there? Or?
You mean like the small caps versus?
No, like for example,
automation.
Yeah, those are lowercase versus uppercase. That it's downloaded from Munis.
Okay.
That's for some reason whoever entered that line into Munis did it lowercase.
Okay.
Before I got here.
No, I thought maybe perhaps.
Isn't that the only thing? Really?
It was a clue.
25 years before.
It was a clue for you.
There was some cue there.
You know,
you were
telling you something.
Right.
Yeah.
That's insider stuff.
You know. And that's what I do when I make changes.
All right. Okay. Conservation Commission. Change.
Nope.
Inland Wetlands Commission? No change.
That's
43 cents.
That's what I haven't yet out for.
Okay.
This is an OPEB funding schedule. Now, I have a schedule.
There's a new line item here, right? 51.33.
Right.
Okay.
This is for the new line item, OPEB contribution.
Okay.
and how that number came to be. And this is somewhat of a, hopefully it's not a confusing schedule, but I tried to do the best I could to help you to understand the way I came up with this.
Yeah, this is helpful.
Confusing.
Making something simple complicated.
Give him a chance.
Okay, so, you know, I don't know, there seems to be a lot of interest on some people to understand where I came up with that figure, and the best way I can do it.
Okay.
So here it goes. In 2009, you'll see the annual required contribution, just the top line to $1.1 million, okay? The pay-as-you-go budget is basically our existing budget for retirees, which gives you a difference of unfunded ARC, so to speak. ARC is the annual required contribution.
So we're going to put in 515 to begin with.
Right.
This is going to be the
this is 25%
the underfunded.
That's what's required.
Portion.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
It's 25% of the unfunded portion. And all it does is step that up 25, 40, 60, 80, 100 over 5 years. That's basically it.
Yeah.
That makes sense, right?
Yeah.
So okay. We're going to contribute this year's, or next year, 149,150,000.
Now there's one other slight wrinkle.
Yeah.
And that is the reserve.
2013 is a big wrinkle.
That's
100. There's the health insurance reserve, which has got $500,000 in it, and that is additional funding for.
Oh, I said to that adult.
I use that for additional funding for not this year but next year. So we would start using the reserve in 2010. This is part of that.
I see.
Because. Just because next year you have the debt service at the firehouse, you've got a lot of things hit. So I thought it would, and another one on the Board of Education side is this year they had a significant reduction in special education. Next year they're not so sure. And you see theirs actually goes down from, if you look at their OPEB budget line, it's at 127,763. If you look at the one on the Board of Ed, it's in the same spot. Theirs actually goes down next year by a few $1,000.
Just explain 2013 again to me, Tony.
That's when we'll be fully funded. Every year in our budget for the our annual required contribution, you'll see our funding matches the annual required contribution at the top.
Okay.
So you'll see.
So in 2013, we're only paying $852 and change.
That'll be the additional funding for towards the.
On top of the 750.
Correct.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
I was hoping that was not.
Now, another thing when you look at the schedule is. You'll see there's a big jump between 2010 and 2011, from 160 to 360.
Double your money.
Yeah, and that's
why are we going up so high?
Because the current union contracts are up in 2010.
Okay.
So I'm hopeful that
you're taking the inflation and the contracts and adding that in together.
Well, I'm hopeful that there'll be some language changes in the contracts to help reduce the liability.
Right.
Okay. Hence, as the new hires and that kind of thing.
Yeah, right. Various things planned, the new hires, the whole thing, which will significantly change the our annual contribution to begin with.
And that's going to be a significant part of our town budget.
Right.
Mm-hmm. How much of that? I mean, I don't know what our town budget will be in 2013, but.
But hopefully, though, over time, by investing this money.
Right.
Okay, that's where it will come back down.
Right.
Okay. That was our plan.
What's the payout? Where the crossover is? Where it's funded?
The payout was, in terms of years, you mean? How many years?
Yeah.
I don't remember the schedule, but it was.
It's on one of those graphs.
Yeah. It wasn't too far out.
Yeah.
It was maybe about 10 years, maybe? Not even quite 10 years.
Maybe 20. Yeah, 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
12 years, yeah.
So this is just a suggestion.
Is it possible to do it at a slower rate in those last few years?
You could.
Okay.
You could.
So we're not committed.
Not committed to any of this, except for the 149,000.
Right, understood.
Right.
Right. And I think, I mean, I like the approach, maybe through 2011.
You can do it from
can change it each year.
Absolutely. Next year you can revisit the whole thing.
Right.
And say, you know what, I think the important thing that I wanted to establish was when we go for a rating agency review in probably October, to be able to say, here's our schedule, here's our plan, board did it, the town did it, we're addressing the situation.
Right.
And then after that.
I think that's very reasonable.
Right.
Very reasonable, yeah.
Very good.
And it's very understandable, Tony.
That's great.
You got it now, Chip.
I got it more than I need.
Okay. Now, a lot of the health insurance in the retirement I'll probably get, the retirement usually comes in March from the state. Usually they'll tell us to match it from the state fund. And then the health care hopefully will be usually in April.
Okay. Now, can I just clarify this?
Sure.
The Woodbridge Board of Education, okay, their health insurance is tied to ours.
Right.
Correct. Now, right. I know that it's based on claims, so if their claims right. are different than our claims, then their rates may be a little...
Or is it all together?
Okay. So will they have the opportunity, based on what we negotiate, to change what's in their budget? Okay. Why can't that happen?
They're to give us their requests by the 1st of February. Once the requests are here, it's now Board of Selectmen recommends the Board of Finance.
But if we know before we get to the final budget...
You couldn't make that change.
We can make
the
change.
The board can't. Sure, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that absolutely. Once we know those rates,
absolutely.
We should make that adjustment
absolutely.
To their budget.
Call them up, tell us to rerun the figures based on the current rates, and I'm sure it won't be a problem.
Okay.
And then you just make that adjustment.
I'd like to recommend that we do that this year.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Both MRF and healthcare.
Yeah. Yep.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Next is debt service.
There's no change in debt service. We're still anticipating the borrowing in December, which means the first interest payment is next June of 2009. As you can hear tonight, that seems like it's pretty realistic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, next is Woodbridge Board of Education.
Okay.
And Woodbridge Board of Education, there are two reductions. The first is I took their OPEB number that they had in there and reduced it to ratchet out of that number.
We're going over with Chuck.
They're in agreement. At least
Chuck is in agreement. Yeah. We're not speaking for the board of it.
He's in agreement with the method.
That's great.
Right.
Okay.
The second is, again, we can't obviously make any cuts to the budget. It's just
bottom line
thing. Got it. And it's $22,560 for the audit okay. of the business office. So those are the
ones. And do we pledge them to them to help them in terms of looking at their
anytime.
So it's not that we're saying it's not necessary, we just think there's an alternative way to do this that doesn't need to cost that much money. Okay.
Okay. So does everyone understand that?
So the bottom line, what we would be recommending to the Board of Finance on the Board of Education budget is
$11,861,733.
Okay. All right, great. Okay, then next is Amity Regional School District.
That's out of press there.
Yeah.
I got a funny
page.
This is really
the whole thing is my favorite page.
To be frank. Yeah. Okay, and then transfers from the general.
This is capital.
Yeah.
So this is probably something we can do the capital budget.
Okay. So we can move on to the capital budget. Okay. Unless anyone has any questions.
Great
job. Hold on, 1 second. I think one of the things I'm recommending to myself and to Tony is to we got to date these.
We do have them dated for some reason.
I just wrote on 2/19/08 on both of them. I didn't see the date.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
so we should do that.
You know.
On which one?
On any document that we prepare to submit to you, there should be a date on it when you.
Oh, okay.
When it's being,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
On the capital, it's on the last page.
Yeah, it's on the last page, okay. Yeah, we can put it on, yeah.
We can put it on every page.
Yeah, I think that's about it.
Yeah.
Okay, so we start with the Board of Education?
Yes. The Board of Education has, you can see there are four changes there, as to 12, 13, 14, and 15. Primarily because they have a significant number of amount of funds in the current budget that hasn't been spent. Primarily, one is windows, for example. And I want to say that's about $150,000. And they don't plan on doing that piecemeal, but rather doing it all at once when there's a building project, which means that you have $140,000, $50,000, I believe is what it is, in funds in their capital budget that isn't being used.
Now, since it wasn't though designated with these uses,
you have to.
What's the process that needs to be followed for them to use these new purposes?
It's a change in appropriation as opposed to new money or contingency. So it's my understanding that it has to simply follow the Board of Selectmen, Board of Finance, for transferring funds.
Okay, so that basically a request was from them
to the Board of Selectmen for transfer, actually to me, and I present to the Board of Selectmen, say for $40,000 for, you know, rug replacements.
Okay.
From the windows to, you know, that kind of thing.
Okay. I mean, just to make it clear, I think that they were planning on using that money towards the major project.
Oh, okay.
Above.
Okay.
But I think that your strategy is fine in terms of use it just for this now, and we'll fund that into a big project in a different way. That's
fine. Yeah.
Okay. Just so I can explain.
They wanted to use it as seed money for the existing projects.
Correct.
There's also several other, there's several other projects in there, that I'm not sure where they are with.
There may be money available there, correct?
Right.
There's money left over from the heat pump at the nurse's heat pump.
Right.
There's money left over from several projects.
Okay. That's fine.
So there may be some opportunity.
I think that's a very reasonable suggestion, Tony. I just also like to say, though, I think when it comes to the track and the nature trail, I actually think that it'd be pretty successful from a fundraising perspective. And I mean, I will bring that to their attention. That instead of asking for reappropriation for that, I'd like to see them fundraise first, and that whatever the remainder is, to ask for the appropriation at that point in time.
What's the land trust in Waikiki? They have a history of that.
You go ask them.
Okay. All right. Board of Selectmen?
Actually, can I ask one more question? I'm sorry. So basically, we're recommending that we would basically go out for bond funding, or it has to go to first, of course?
For
the major project.
Yes, the major project, actually. I have I did like a summary on that, on like a debt
layout over time.
And, it's based on when you want to bond this project, and how it fits with some of the other projects.
Right.
And
with the firehouse, the public works building, the school,
right.
Wrap everything together.
Well, you would want to do it so that you take advantage of debt falling off from other projects.
Okay. Right.
And fund it so that
minimize
the impacts of taxpayers, basically.
Okay.
So with the analysis that you did, is there a recommended time frame that you have for them?
Yeah. Well, that's open to discussion. I just did this based on not so much time frame of when it makes sense from a debt perspective. I'm not saying you have to do this.
Sure.
Of course. But I'll just pass it on. It's just a simple little time. These are the four basic projects. These are the four basic projects here. So you see that it's pushed out a bit. And that's when it would be the most optimal from a bond or
from a tax impact.
From a tax impact, it's pretty much straight, relatively straight increase, over a period of years.
So you're recommending that it would be pushed out to 5/11?
5/11. What I did was, if you look at the planning stage, I figured this is just, again, an estimate, but if it takes like a year for planning, you know, to create a building committee, file paperwork with the state, you need to come up with planning, you got an RFP for an architect, so you have all that paperwork, all that stuff. And then a referendum.
2/12.
Yeah, then a year from referendum to a little less than a year, to issuing notes to start the project. Mm-hmm. Then you have to come up with construction drawings, you have to come up with a bid, you have to do all that stuff. And then a year for construction. And then after that, 6 months for your first interest payment.
Mm-hmm. How about the open space, the $2 million?
That's in your budget. It's in the capital plan, which is why it's in here. It's in
the budget. We need to discuss that going on.
I mean, if you adopt this budget without it, then I take it out of here. But as long as you have it in your plan, I keep it in my planning.
Okay. Would that change at all then what you might recommend?
It would.
Okay. That was my next point.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I just wonder whether Beecher is more important than more open space at this point. And that $2 million is not something we have planned. We planned it for the budget. There's nothing we have an option to buy with that $2 million at this point.
We don't have anything on the horizon.
Well, my feeling is Beecher would be more important than putting $2 million away for open space. I don't know how other people feel about that.
Maybe a portion. Only because when things do come up, it's good to have some of that money. We found that the fact that we buy open space helps keep the taxes down.
I understand, but also the schools help keep our taxes down. And which is why not doing construction on Beecher for another 5 years, I'm just afraid it's going to approach the condition of one of the junior highs that we had to totally redo. That's my fear.
I just don't want to drain the whole budget. Absolutely have to drain that whole budget, but I would certainly agree that we could siphon money off and push it into the.
Would you like? Well,
can we get any projection on properties that might become available? We have some sense of that.
As far as I know, there's none. There's none on the horizon right now that we're talking.
There's a number of properties identified in the town plan of conservation and development that would make nice open space purchases, but I don't know that any of them necessarily are going to come up anytime soon. But you know, in a year from now, we could be sitting here saying, well, the property is now available, and now what do we do?
Well, again,
we don't get a lot of
I understand that, and I really appreciate that. I'd like us to supply more open space, but I'd also like to see the future remediation.
I agree.
I think 2013 is a long way off to start doing the remediation of a school that, to me, is in danger of having some serious problems unless we do some significant remediation. I don't want to see us doing what we had to do with the Amity situation.
Do you want to drain the whole $2 million?
Well, I'm open to whatever. What money
do we have on hand for open space?
Not much, because we are right now we have very little. We'll have if you transfer the money from the power line on the Clearview Road. Mm-hmm. Then I'm just enough to pay for phase three
of Racebrook,
right?
That would pretty much be the end of the road.
I mean, we basically know that it will take 2 years, okay, to do all of the planning and the referendum and, you know, beginning the work, and then you pay after the work is completed. Right. So there's a definite 2-year window there,
right,
that you have. Mm-hmm. So the question is, if you delay that by 1 year or 2 years
Why not just reverse this open space and teach it?
You could certainly put open space further out on the spectrum.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The thing about open space is it's not a big enough issue to do in and of itself. That's why I coupled it with the public works facility.
Right, right.
You won't have much of a market on a $2 million issue.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
That's why it made sense to group those two together.
Now, we had some money set aside for public works. Right.
We do. This is based on the last budget that we received from when we had the last site plan, which was close to $4 million. If you remember, 3.5 maybe. This is based on that.
If we reduced it to, like, say, the open space to $500,000 and took $1.5 million from open space and put it towards Beecher, would that be enough to make any difference in your title?
That's what I'm thinking. It's probably not going to make that much of a difference.
No, I'm just bringing out a number to
satisfy.
No, that's
what I was thinking, too.
Yeah. I think if you, then the public works facility is another question. I mean, if that debt service was less earlier on, then you could push up the others because you'd have lower payments going out.
I mean, I really agree with Jim that I think we do have to prioritize, and there may not be enough money to go around to everything that we want to do. I mean, we've been through this beach remediation multiple times already with many, many different kinds of plans, and I think we do need to make a commitment to be able to move forward on this.
Sooner than what is projected here.
Right. And it doesn't mean that if an open space opportunity became available that we wouldn't figure out another strategy in terms of what to do. I mean, we could do something with that. We just may not have that money set aside in account waiting for us at that point.
So, Tony, if we...
You could push it up. You could say, you push it up a year, change this, move this around. How does it look? That would be around the numbers.
Yeah.
That's basically the idea of this whole thing, is the starting point, really.
So if we kept open space to half a mil.
Okay.
What do you think?
No, well, whatever we put open space at, we should keep some money. I believe we should keep some money in there. And I agree that 2011 is a long time to push that out. Mm-hmm. Remediation is a long time.
It would actually be about 2013.
Right. 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 You're saying you want to start working on it.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right. It's a long time.
Yeah. So that's a long time.
Yeah.
Right. And I could see saying to them, well, it's 6 months or maybe it's a year because of the finances. Mm-hmm. But I think doing any more than that is just not
prudent
on our part.
I agree. It's way
out. No, I just afraid we're going to get into a bad situation with Beecher and deterioration. Once it starts, it's a logarithmic.
So, do you want to show us the impact of...
I thought we'd start with some ideas, and then I could run the numbers based on what you're thinking in terms of timing, and then you could see the impact.
Yeah.
And then,
if we could work some
figures... As opposed to doing it with the impact now, and then you want to change it anyway.
Yeah.
I thought it would be helpful just to run over...
Public works and open space.
Can we perhaps, instead of talking about the dollars... amounts and stuff, when we talk about doing Beecher planning for the referendum, say in 2011 rather than 2012 or even 2010, I could move the referendum. The referendum right now is for 2012.
Right.
Can we talk about moving the referendum up a year or two?
Yeah.
And then work from that basis?
Yeah, I would like to move it to 10 if we could, actually.
But why don't we ask Tony to look at moving the referendum to 10
and then watch
what the numbers come up with, rather than us trying to give any numbers.
Right, the numbers aren't as concerning as the schedule.
Okay.
That's the driver.
One thing I've learned sitting next to Tony, don't give him numbers, let him give you the numbers.
Okay, so moving the Beecher referendum up to
2010.
Right. Yeah. That's a problem. And then, and the amount, in terms of the amounts, you'll review that once I give you the thing.
Yeah.
And you say, well, let's move this.
Tell us how
we
use
this. You mean the amount is the open space?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless you want me to change
but
it.
Maybe you could run it with different open space numbers.
I could.
Yeah.
Right.
Run it with different.
All
right.
500.
Sure. 500.
0,
500.
Yeah.
500.
Just nervous about open space because that's one of the reasons why our annual budget is going down. Partly that.
The other thing is, we have been lucky, knock on wood, we haven't been getting 400,000 here, 400,000 there, and I don't know if that'll continue. But we seem to have gotten some extra money every couple of years that we could, as we have earmarked for open space as it comes in. I think we've done a pretty good job of that.
Right.
Okay, no problem. All right?
Yep.
Okay. The filing systems were moved out a year in 2010,
mm-hmm.
And there's actually a town clerk's applying for a grant for that.
That's great.
So $50,000 grant. So we're hopeful. So we don't want to fund it when we're applying for a grant. Basically.
The assessor. That's a revaluation.
Yep. Not much. No.
Okay. Police.
Police. We didn't make a change there. Right?
Fire department.
Okay, I have my last, I promise.
Exhibit number XXX.
This is my last one.
Here we go.
What I have here is, actually, this has changed since I actually went over this with the chief. And this is simply a planning tool to try to come up with a funding schedule or some sort of a schedule for funding fire trucks. And basically what I was trying to do is flatten as much as possible the impact on the budget if your objective was to acquire all three of those vehicles. Three of the vehicles being the ladder truck, the tanker truck, and the rescue truck. They may not want to do that, in which case this is a planning mechanism for...
Well, the rescue truck is, again...
It's a done deal.
Rescue truck's a done deal.
Right.
And actually, that number changed. There was some... this number actually has to change to the lease payment goes up a little. To $103,000.
Okay. You have that there, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're talking about a ladder truck, just to put this in the context of reality, it was 32 years old.
Right.
So, you know, I think we got our money's worth.
Back in the shop, all right? Back in the shop.
Okay. So.
So just to explain how it works, there's the purchase, these are just rough estimates on purchase price, based on talking with the chief and, you know, what his estimate is as to where, obviously we'll pay these, but, and then there's existing funds, which we have currently in the capital budget for the ladder truck and the tanker truck. The rescue truck does have $300,000, but there's $103,000 for the first lease payment, which actually the truck should be here in March, according to the chief. And then $50,000 for the jaws of life. That we, if you recall, we took off the original price. So that leaves you $295,000 for the ED fund, which is the remainder of the lease.
Is the ladder truck the lease to buy?
The ladder truck's the lease to buy, which is, I did it a lease, you can do it in a lease in advance, you can do a lease in arrears.
Okay.
This is a lease in arrears, which means you would acquire the truck a year before you can.
Right. How about the tanker? The tanker, is that just a straight purchase?
The tanker is actually a straight purchase.
Okay. Is there any way, I never heard this addressed, is there any way to lease to buy a tanker?
The thing with the tanker, you could.
Or we're thinking to do a remodification.
Right,
it was a remodification of the old truck, Joe.
It's actually two tankers.
Two tankers.
Yeah.
One, so you really can't do that.
Anymore. One is going to be a purchase, actually, in 2009 of about $200,000.
Right.
The second one will be a refurbished tanker in 2012, which is basically, if I understand it, using the old tank, putting it on a new truck.
So there
were two chats.
Correct. So according to you talked to the chief, he was talking about getting the ladder truck in 2011?
All I did was run the numbers by the chief and make sure my assumptions were correct.
Okay, because I don't think the ladder truck, when we have it, going to last
to 2011. No, it's not 2011. The ladder truck will come in 2010.
Okay.
Which means you need a year to probably put the
committee
together
okay.
and do out the bid, do all that, which is 2000.
But our first payment would be in 2011.
Right.
Even okay.
Because so the delivery of the truck in 2010.
I'm sorry, you told me that. Okay.
Right.
Gotcha.
Delivery's in 2010, which means you probably order it in 2009, which means you start building in 2008.
Okay. So the truck comes in 2010. Okay.
I imagine it takes a year to probably order the thing at least.
Yeah.
So this is just gives you an idea of, you know, how you can accomplish that, and you'll see the impact: 200,000, 160, 246, 186. I tried to flatten out.
Yeah, no, that's actually reasonable.
I think you've done a good job on that, Tony. Especially that it would kill us to try and pay for this ladder truck in 2 or 3 years.
Oh God.
Right. I thought, considering we got 30 years out of our existing 5-year lease, is probably not a bad deal.
Right.
Or longer.
You could even do it longer.
No, this is good. I mean, it does really even it out tremendously. I like that a lot.
Okay.
Is there any other fire?
So you have to adjust the couple
of things. Yeah, right. So the tankers, the dollars change.
Right, the dollars change on the tanker and on the rescue.
Let's say we lost it in the ladder truck this year or next year.
You just have to change some of these.
We'll change some back to the Board of Selectmen, change these numbers.
Right.
Okay.
It's just a planning tool, really.
Yeah. Right.
And you try to use the planning tool. If something happens,
we have 192 right now. We could use that to begin the lease.
You have $200,000 right into the line.
So we could use that to begin to do these, okay.
Yeah.
But this is a plan to do it, it's the first time.
Right, well, I understand, but I'm just saying, just in case that ladder truck, we start getting a $200,000 bill to fix a 39-year-old ladder truck.
We'll have to pull money out of the open space account.
Good thing we set it aside, right?
Everybody will hate us.
Okay. Okay, building official, there's nothing. Public Works, there's no changes, right?
No.
Okay.
We made the changes there.
Building maintenance.
We did make a couple of changes here. The suggestion on building maintenance was that numbers 5, 6, and 7 be paid for out of the library capital reserve account.
You know, that's that account that has about $125,000 in it.
Right. Because they're all library related items.
That's an excellent suggestion.
I totally agree. Did you talk to the library commission about that?
No.
Thank you. I talked to you first.
I thought of you first.
Oh, go for it.
Man, where is your courage?
Your strength in numbers, you know.
I don't blame them.
Wear that bulletproof vest.
Jerry, we'll send Jerry.
That's right, they wouldn't harm her. No, I think that makes sense.
We've talked about it the last 2 years.
Yeah.
Makes sense. I mean, we did get a firm definition of what that account was supposed to be for, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, and these purchases or repairs would fall within the definition of what that account is for,
that's
correct?
Right.
We agree.
Okay, so that's the rationale.
Okay. All right, human services, there's no
change.
Recreation, there is, right?
Yeah, actually, I think John said it in his presentation.
Yeah, I think that's what he wants to do.
Yeah, we'll put that out another year to see if he can get another year out of the
utility.
Right.
No change in pool and gym?
Nope.
Or parks?
Parks, yeah.
That's it.
Okay.
Good job, huh? Okay. Now.
And just for the record, the result is.
That's a fun
sheet
of pile of paper there.
Here.
Oh, thanks. It's the mill rate is 31.08, which is 3.77% increase above prior year. And this is actually the grand list as of the adopted grand list. So if there's any changes in the Board of Assessment Appeals, we'll propose it.
And what is the current mill rate? 29.95.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, I just wanted to.
Oh, right.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, that's fantastic. I mean, I haven't seen an increase less than 4% on the first run ever. So.
We also funded the firehouse, both firehouses for the whole year, so there may be some increase there, too.
Hope that we put in there.
Yeah.
That service.
So, great job to Ed and Tony.
So, what we need to do now is to have a motion to approve this.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually revenue, too. Revenue, okay, well, we'll go to revenue. Yeah, I do. Okay.
That's a little bit of
apologize for the small font.
Are you scratching our eyes?
This is it here.
Oh, okay, yeah. No, I could read that.
I tried to make it as large as I could. The non-tax, we start at the top, the non-tax revenue. The non-tax revenue is pretty much based on where we think our actuals will be. That's basically prior property tax revenue and other interest. Intergovernmental, it is based on the governor's budget. I'm not sure if there'll be any, I don't think there'll be any changes upward, unless you have some more.
Ellen, can you hang on that, please?
I don't know about that one either, but we took that gamble last year and it did pretty well.
It served us well. We've had a historically, right, over the years.
There's also a new budget line in there, citations. You see it there? 8,000. Those are the citations for the tickets.
Where was that before, Tim?
That's new.
New, actually. They're sharing some money with us.
Yeah, the state's sharing money with us.
Overspent.
All 8,000.
More tickets we get, the more overspent.
We already have the reputation.
A lot of cell phone users in Woodbridge.
There are.
Oh, God, let's not go.
I was driving a car.
Bad topic.
The 2150 in the last line is the GATVOC grant for the payment for the GATVOC budget. I think it's 2150. And department charges, the conveyance taxes is one that hopefully does not get sunsetted.
Well, I think that's good for this year, right? For next year.
Again, not sure about that one.
Come on, Alan. Come on.
My charge.
I mean, I don't know if you know, do you have any recommendations on some of these? If you want to, you know, I mean, some of them are guesstimates as to where, like building permits, you know, the Woodbridge Village could go through and
skyrocket that.
Right. Skyrocket.
Right. But we're better off not.
Yeah, usually you don't project for stuff like that.
Exactly.
There's a slight cooling in that, and also an interest income, which is right below there, and also in conveyance taxes. And then I guess that it's not quite as robust as it has been. Couple other highlights here. There's an AMITI surplus of 166,127. We know that's a real number. Kept the fund balance appropriation of 400,000. And this is something that next year, if you see the budget, if something hits that you're not anticipating, you can always increase that a little, because you do have that debt service from the fire station. That's just where I recommended it this year. Again, next year you might not get, the other wild card there is you might not get an AMITI surplus one year. And so that would be a good year to increase it.
Where are we putting that surplus? Is that going into contingency or just general fund?
What happens is it goes into general fund, and then if the budget passes, I'll earmark it for the, you know, if this passes at the town meeting, it's earmarked for the following year to offset taxes.
Okay, cool.
So it does go into general fund.
Okay.
Basically no change.
Not very many. I just made a lot of changes to the state grant, a lot of numbers.
Okay. 2006 was a good year.
It was building permits. We were at over 300,000, maybe with the Toll Brothers. Were in.
Yeah.
We were at like 2-3 years here where we were 300, 350.
Eldersley,
right. Right.
And it's also when we had our sale. That was a sewer authority, right?
Mm-hmm.
In 2006.
We should sell some more sewers.
Yeah, the 541.
They're all gone. They're all gone.
Right. Sorry. That's
the
541. Correct.
So.
You had one, that's all you got.
You can sit on the board if you like.
No,
I'm done.
Okay, so, yep.
So we need a motion now to accept the budget as recommended.
Second.
Second. Well, there's a few changes that we had.
As amended.
Right.
As amended. As amended.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Good.
And so you'll run out the final numbers.
Yep.
Okay. And then there's a second. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thanks for a great job.
Okay. Well, why don't you just report on the, at our last meeting last week, we had a discussion about the property on Amity Road there, Bradley Road, and the billboard and that, and you had a conversation with Jim Freed.
Yeah, actually Jim Freed did the research, and because he's not here, I will give you my, what I recollect from our discussion, and that is that the first question was, is it available? And according to DOT, it is not available. And they actually have a deposit on the property.
Really?
From another buyer?
Correct.
Okay.
I don't know anything more than that, as to the amount or anything like that, we didn't bother, you know.
Okay.
Inquiring, but their opinion that is not available.
Okay, and so far as the town's right of first refusal option.
Right.
That is.
Is over.
Right. Okay. And that's been communicated, or should have been communicated to Roger Harrison by Jim Perito today. Approximately today we do that. So that's that. Then the other thing is, I did tell you that I was going to have a meeting with the police department and the building inspector and the principal of the teen center in regard to activities there. And we had a very good meeting this morning. Joe Heller was there. We met for about an hour. And the bottom line is that the teen center is going to, for any event they have there, inform the police department of their the anticipated attendance. And then the police department will assign the necessary number of police officers for that event. We were told that the bands that performed a week ago Saturday are not going to be asked to come again, that type of band. Their next event is on March 1. It's a fundraiser, and they expect about 100 people to be there, so they will notify Chief Marcucci and tell them what they expect the attendance to be, and then the police will assign the necessary officers.
And who will pay for the police?
They will.
They will. Okay.
And then there are several, another event maybe in mid-March, and then there's an event at the end of April. A band from Israel is going to come and perform on, I guess it's Passover Saturday, so we'll make arrangements for whatever necessary security for that.
They'll probably bring the hose.
They may. And so, but I think the lines of communication are open, so the police want to work with them, and we want to make sure that, you know, everybody is secure who wants to attend this.
That's the way it was supposed to work before, right? So this was just sort of a lapse.
The police were not notified of the event on Friday night, which was a teen event. They were notified of this band event on Saturday because of the robbery that occurred on Friday night. There were three arrests were made today, I believe, in regard to that robbery on Friday night.
Wow.
Good.
So.
Good. Were
they teens? I didn't get the details on
the... Two of them are over 21.
No.
Neither of those people are from our town. And in the area, once we're through, we'll go for Florida.
And their zoning application was granted with a number of other stipulations, like cleanup, an hour after the event, they were all cleaned up. Did that come up in conversation? They did have a complaint from the bank.
We had several complaints, yeah, and they are attempting to do that, but that's a matter that is not within the police jurisdiction.
No, it's not. Yeah. But it is within the jurisdiction.
It is, and it's my understanding they're going to do that.
And you also distributed a letter to Dr. Brady from G. Marcucci, Chief of Police, about them wanting to utilize a Connecticut State Police drug detection canine at the high school.
Right.
I hadn't really heard about this before, but do you happen to know what Dr. Brady's
All I know is that that's a recommendation of the Woodbridge Police Department and the Police Commission, although the vote was not unanimous on that.
I think there's a policy meeting scheduled.
That's what I'm told. I was told today there's a policy meeting. I don't know the exact date when the
I think next week sometime.
The our representatives to the Amity Board of Education will be discussing that, and along with Dr. Brady, of course. And so we'll find out how they do.
So is the decision the board's decision?
It is.
The Board of Education.
It is.
Okay, it's not the Police Commission's decision. It's their recommendation to do this and making this available.
Right.
If this was made available, is this increased cost to the town then?
That I don't know. I know we don't have a dog.
Right. Oh. Unless someone's donating.
Unless we get Laura.
That's what you're talking
about. Yanti.
I've got a schnoodle you can borrow.
So just to follow up on that, does that mean that we have, this is something that does not come before us unless it's a budget matter?
Correct. It's a matter of the Police Commission and... and the school board.
And what about in the letter where it says that, it's support of the Woodbridge Board of Police Commissioners and other Woodbridge town officials? Does anybody know what that's about or what it is?
No.
I would ask that they not use that kind of language unless they're going to specify who specifically is in support of that. I mean, this is a pretty contentious issue, and this could be very divisive. And I think it's misleading to use that kind of a statement in a letter like this.
Okay, I'll pass that on. Okay, so I think that exhausts our agenda. And we will meet again, I guess our next regularly scheduled meeting is March 12th.